Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Pash On Podcast. Let's get started with your host, Brian Pash.
Hi, this is Brian Pash, and welcome to another podcast session. I'm pleased to have on today's show Amy Hughes. She's the Senior Director of Dealer Intelligence at Experian. Amy, welcome to the show.
Brian, thank you for having me. Always lovely to be with you and your team.
Well, listen, it is a strange time in the automotive industry. Every day seems to be a new announcement, maybe a rise in hopes, a defeat in hope. Just this week, the EU banned travel from the United States into Italy. I'm sad. How have you been coping with all these changes during the COVID lockdown?
Yeah, it's crazy times, certainly. And we in the Hughes household are healthy and do not take that for granted. Certainly, we've been on the automotive industry front looking to bring as much intelligence to the industry about the situation. And we appreciate you giving us the opportunity to share some of that today. But on a personal note, we are good and healthy and grateful. Hope that your team is staying healthy as well.
Yes, we are. We've been very fortunate. In fact, our president of the agency just had a baby girl this week. So in spite of all the craziness with COVID, life goes on. And for dealers, they've seen some record months, Amy, May and June, almost like there was this pent-up demand and a huge release. But as we're going to talk about at the DMSC virtual live stream conference in just a few days, COVID has changed the way people shop, and Experian has a unique perch to see so much data. And on today's podcast, I want to talk about the data sets that stand out. You do have some free online tools for dealers to review all of the information we're going to talk about today. So, Amy, let's start with this one kind of high level. What does Experian and the data science team feel about how people are shopping for cars? Is it a short-term pattern? Is it a long-term pattern? What at a very high level could you tell us about what you're seeing?
Certainly. Obviously, the situation for the industry and Americans in particular remains very fluid. And our dealerships need to understand, I think most pertinently, the consumer sentiment across the nation, but also in their local markets. And so what we're seeing is that, at least in the short term, there will be some car shoppers who are more hesitant to re-enter the market, who potentially may delay their purchase. And by looking into the consumer sentiment, our dealers can begin to identify whether or not that is affecting the shoppers near their store.
And Amy, what I thought was really amazing, and of course you're going to be talking more about it in detail at DMSC, is that Experian has different buckets of consumers, different regions of the country. So dealers can, using your free online tools, really look into their local market, the different age groups, and the sentiment, as you were saying, what they are currently thinking about shopping. And let's talk about that. Your consumer sentiment dashboard obviously is tracking more than automotive. What else is it tracking? What other industries? Because people who listen to our podcast are often entrepreneurs and maybe are not aware of all the different data points that Experian is offering right now in regards to this COVID crisis.
Right. No, certainly. It's the way the data comes together to inform cuts across many verticals. So that's a great key point to take a look at. Obviously, automotive is a huge driver of our economy, but we're also looking at the financial services industry. We're looking at health, retail, and media consumption, and what are the changes in consumer behavior and consumer sentiment that we should take note of as we look to formulate our rebound and our recovery strategies. So across the board, we recommend dealers take a look at that data. And as you mentioned, it's available, it's updated daily. It's a nationwide consumer survey, but it's broken down in such a way that it makes it quite digestible and full of aha moments for our dealers.
And for dealers who are listening to today's podcast, I will include in the podcast description a link to the Experian Consumer Sentiment Dashboard so that you can play around with the data. Also, I'm going to be including a link where you can request a personalized market report from the Experian team. This is a bonus for the DMSC conference, so we're really excited to share that with you. So, Amy, let's start at a very high level about people, according to your data, who are in the market over the next few months to buy. Are consumers, you know, as a majority planning on moving forward? Obviously, we're talking now nationally. What are you seeing as some specific percentages of consumers who we would call in market or planning to buy?
Absolutely. So the good news is that the what we term the automotive well-being index is actually higher and is steadily grown since the pandemic began to change consumer sentiment. Right now, as the data stands, 23% of consumers are considering buying a new vehicle in the next few months. And that's across the entire nation. Of those consumers, even better news is that 60% are planning to just move forward with that purchase as planned. So looking closer at the data, there are noticeable differences in sentiment between generations and population size or urbanization. For instance, Gen X is the generation with the highest percentage of consumers looking to buy a vehicle in the next few months at 36%, which is higher, obviously, than that national average. However, the baby boomer generation is significantly lower. They're coming in around 8%. So what we like to do by breaking the data down is help make it local and relevant and actionable for dealers. If they take a look at the consumers that their dealership is continually serving, kind of analyze what type of demographic data exists within their own customer database, then they're able to understand how drastically they need to respond to the shift in consumer sentiment.
Amy, thing that jumped off the page to me was the baby boomer. Is there any insights or thoughts? I mean, I'm not an expert on which brands baby boomers may have a tendency to select, but let's just say it's Buick GMC is a baby boomer brand. Why do you think baby boomers are so low? If the national average is 23%, they're significantly lower. Any insights to why that may be?
Well, it's important to understand that each dealership can, in that offering that you mentioned at the onset of the podcast, Brian, each dealership can actually get a view into the demographics and the lifestyle categories that are important by make, those lifestyles that have been purchasing Buick models, for instance. And from that data, they can understand, again, how drastic is the impact. As it relates to the consumer sentiment data, as you drill into the generations a bit, you can see by generation that really at the baby boomer level, they're among the least likely to have an automotive payment that they need to make monthly. They're at the least likely to have difficulty with that payment. As we've already covered, they're at the least likely to consider buying a new car. But what is interesting is they just seem to be across the board the most affected by this drastic change. They are among sort of the least likely, if they are going to continue with their purchase, to buy something less expensive than planned. They're among the least likely to sort of consider leasing instead. So they seem to have a bit of a set in their ways mentality. And that's no offense to any of my boomer friends, but it is what the data is telling us.
Well, I think that's fascinating because I will say that boomers have been through good times and bad times. And probably at this point, they're worrying about conserving cash. Obviously, during the COVID crisis, if you think about how far the market went down, no one knew if there was a cure. No one knew how long it was going to take to find a cure. A lot of uncertainty. And probably, as you mentioned, these are people who are in better financial straits. They probably can hold the car longer or desire to hold the car longer because it's not a leasing market so much. And what I love about the Experian data is, just as you mentioned, dealers can look at their brands, but also in their local market based on the urbanization, size of their markets, based on their brand, based on age. I love this. It's funny that my in-laws, she's been leasing Hyundais, her lease is up. She didn't even flinch. She was like, okay, I want another Hyundai. Brian, let's go to the dealership. And, you know, all she wants to know is, can I get that same car in the same color? She knows what she wants. She knows that the payment will be reasonable. So I guess in different parts of the market, in every age category, there's exceptions to the rule. What about the difference, Amy, between like urban areas versus suburban areas? Is there any insights we can get? I've been hearing a lot of news of people in the city who are not taking mass transit. They're thinking about buying cars. Are we seeing any shifts in consumer sentiment in these different types of urban areas?
Yeah, it is interesting. As we've been watching the data week over week, the more positive and more sort of in-market indicators that exist in the more urban areas. And that's in every region, particularly the Northeast. And of course, as we know, the Northeast is, you know, as the entire country has been drastically impacted by this, the Northeast seemed to be out front and in their response and with, you know, mitigating measures for long closures of dealerships, et cetera. So again, it underscores the importance of watching this automotive well-being index. And our recommendation to dealers is that as an executive team, you are looking at this data weekly at a minimum, and that you're beginning to integrate it into your sales meetings. As we know, sharing insight in the midst of uncertainty brings about a cooler heads prevail kind of mindset with your team. And so looking for the stories within the data, making them local and relevant to your team, we just can't underscore the importance of that enough, so that you find the stories like that and you can share them and bring knowledge and insight to your leaders and to your salespeople, so that they can identify with the consumers that are coming in and what are the sort of motivating factors that put them in market for a vehicle. And so by looking at that dealer level dashboard that we were talking about earlier, you can actually quantify in the zip codes that touch your store the exact number of consumers who are coming off lease and are going to be in that situation that you mentioned with your in-laws. So again, just finding the opportunity to inform yourself gives so much more confidence and makes you a much more prepared when your consumers are coming in, because meeting them and hearing their needs is of the utmost importance.
Absolutely. And that allows me to pivot, because I want to ask another question related to this, is reaching these consumers. Now, one of the things that we've seen, I don't know how the Hughes household has been doing, but we've seen companies like Netflix and others surge as a result of binge watching. You know, I'm not sure which series the Hughes family is pushing through, but it's clear that people are watching more video online. Streaming services are kind of booming. Zoom meetings, right, are now the way in which we connect with our families. What can the Experian data science team tell us on, well, maybe some data points that could help a dealer decide where to shift their ad dollars?
Absolutely. And thanks for the question. It has been a staggering sort of view into the growth of media usage. And as a part of these consumer sentiment dashboards, we are tracking both nationwide and at the regional level, what is the shift in media usage and media consumption. And so across the board, you see that the numbers are up significantly. Cable TV is up 24% across all of the channels, with Netflix, as you mentioned, being among the highest at a growth of 41%. So being able to sort of dig into that data and understand how you should be shifting to meet your consumers where they are spending time and where they are consuming media is obviously just as important as understanding their automotive well-being. So we encourage dealers to take a look. One of the things that I found interesting is video game usage is up 28%, and that's, you know, across many different generations. So it's interesting to see that, you know, those types of shifts and those types of surprises. But again, you've got great detail here, everything from television, radio, newspaper, video games, as I mentioned, it's all here. And looking across the board at the generations and again, the population sizes, you can begin to find that story for your store and look at the ways that you can capitalize on it to meet your consumers where they are.
Yes, and I want to remind everyone who's listening to the podcast to look at the links in the podcast description so that you can look at the consumer sentiment dashboard to get that custom report for your market. Amy, one of the questions I had, and I'm not sure if you have a concise answer for this, but this idea that, you know, March and April were tough, a lot of states were locked down. I'm hearing from a lot of dealers, May and June were like record year over year. Are there any states that are standing out? And do you think this will be, at the end of the year, a net increase in sales, or are we just seeing the natural occurrence of low sales in March and April just pushing into May and June?
That's still to be determined, Brian, as it relates to whether or not there'll be net growth. But yes, there are specific states that are showing some really marked increases year over year, and north of 25% growth. So in Pennsylvania, in Maine, in North Dakota, even, we're seeing in our data these stark increases. So the great news is Experian is always tracking that. Through our North American vehicle database, we're able to see not only how the registrations are trending at the hyperlocal level and at the national level, but also, as we've uncovered here, what are the demographic shifts that are occurring there that sort of lead to these increases? And so please stay tuned to all of our quarterly reports, whether that's the automotive state, the automotive finance report that Melinda Zabritsky brings, or our vehicles in operation quarterly report from Marty Miller. We just encourage you to subscribe to that and begin to watch it, because we will continue reporting on that. You can also view the nationwide statistics in the links that we'll be providing for the team here, so that you can track week over week, what does it look like in your state, and look at the web traffic as well, and kind of correlate the two. But yeah, we're always looking out for those outliers where we're seeing that growth, and obviously looking to help our dealers capitalize on it.
Well, I will tell the dealers who are listening to today's podcast that when Amy and her team showed me the dashboards and showed me the customized reports that dealers could get, I was like, okay, man, give me those links. I'm going to start promoting on social media. So as we release this podcast, you'll start to see some display ads on social media and LinkedIn. Why? Because I really want you to see your local market. I want to see your utilization of that data to create different marketing strategies. Here's what I think. Knowing the current sentiment of your customers, and you know what percentage are baby boomers or what percent may be Gen X, you've done that. And now kind of seeing where they're leaning, maybe those who are not so much interested in leasing at this time, maybe to put together a better trade-in finance deal. Or if you have a large population of Gen X and looking, you know, to leverage leasing, let's make sure that you're doing some A/B testing to validate those claims, that instead of just pushing out finance offers, that you're doing some real testing with the data. Amy, I've been talking about hyper-local marketing for the last 18 months when my new book came out. And Experian has the ability to give dealers a hyper-local view and a national view. If someone was on the fence and they haven't been leveraging the Experian data, what could you tell them? Give me one or two reasons why they should really care about that hyper-local market data that you can provide.
Yeah, absolutely, Brian. And we are preaching that same gospel, really, to our dealers. There are marked shifts in what you might find in the demographic data and in the reporting that you see from manufacturers, even on sales effectiveness. There are marked differences in the reporting that you see. And it's important to drill all the way down, look at loyalty statistics at the hyperlocal level, look at your own opportunity to grow market share at the hyperlocal level, zip code by zip code. And just as a proof point of that, what we find looking at dealers across the nation is that on average, in the five zip codes that touch a dealership or that surround it, a new car sort of market share number on average is about 41%. When you dig into the hyperlocal data and you find the insights that help you set yourself apart, you are able to really grow that new car and used car market share significantly. And it's strictly about finding the story within the data. If we're looking at too broad a view, we might make assumptions that are not relevant for our store. And that's simply what it boils down to. So it's been a mission of Experian for quite some time to bring that insight really at no charge to our dealers so they can begin to see where they can grow and see exactly what insights will help them take action and build strategies to meet those consumers where they are. And so it's a lot of fun to make assumptions, you know, take the assumptions that we hear about our market and then actually test those against the data. And until we were able to cut the data at such a hyper-local level, we weren't really able to inform ourselves. And so now that we have that ability, it's really important that you formulate that full view of your consumers who are purchasing. Again, that Buick in North Dakota could be very different, the types of consumers who are looking in a particular zip code versus what you might hear from, a full market level demographic or certainly a national level demographic.
Well, Amy, that's so true from my experience. You know, I grew up in New Jersey most of my life. I've always leased cars. I think in my mind, my friends lease. So I grew up in a leasing mentality. You go to Texas, for example, and they'll say the majority of their customers finance or cash. And these are the insights that honestly, the large dealer groups have had an advantage on for dealers. You know, the AutoNations of the world, the Lithias, the Asburys, what they have data science teams. They can crunch the numbers, but now Experian has allowed a single point store to have these tremendous insights. And on Tuesday, the second day of DMSC, you're leading a workshop entitled Let the Data Tell the Story, How to Cut Through the Noise and Find Actionable Insights. And for the dealers who are attending DMSC, please get your marketing team to listen to this workshop, because at the end of the day, data in all businesses are transforming the efficiency of marketing, the efficiency of messaging, the ability to move the needle in sales, and what Experian is offering you from a single point store up to a dealer group is the insights to allow each store to craft a personalized strategy that meets their needs. Amy, I really want to thank you for not only supporting the DMSC conference, but supporting education, because it's through data that dealers, large and small, can improve. Amy, when you think of one opportunity to summarize what Experian offers dealers, what would one thing? A dealer, again, they're listening to the podcast. I got to do it. They've just been pushing it off. What would you tell them to kind of get them off the fence and take action? Obviously, you talk to dealers, you talk to dealer groups. Why is data today more important than ever?
That's a great question, Brian. And I think just building on what we've already discussed together today, data in these times can really provide a sense of calm and a sense of how we move forward. And I think as you have been talking about for quite some time, making the data your own is really critical. And so one of the things that we'll be talking about in the workshop is how are we shifting our perception of data into something that we can really utilize and really take action on. And you'll be hearing from our dealer panel some really sophisticated users of data that I've worked with for many years and how they've done that in their stores. So my piece of advice is take it in and make it your own. Mm-hmm. Take it in and tell your team how you are taking action on it almost immediately. Data for data's sake is a bit unnerving, especially in a time of uncertainty. So the advice is how you can make it your own and how you can shift your perception of the way that data is presented into this is how it's going to make us more effective. This is how it's going to bring confidence to your one-on-one conversations with your consumers. And when you allow the data to really be owned by your team, you will be shocked at the difference that it makes. So we look forward to sharing that.
Well, Amy, thank you for your time today. And I want to remind dealers that in the links to this podcast, these links are evergreen. So the data is updated every day. So as Amy mentioned, the free national consumer sentiment dashboard is updated daily. You can request also your local market report, which I encourage you to do, and then tune in to the DMSE workshop that Amy's given on Tuesday. Now, if you haven't registered for the virtual live stream DMSC conference, you only have a few days left. And remember, with your ticket, you can see every keynote, every workshop, every panel, because all the recordings will be up for 30 days. So it's the perfect solution to, well, the common complaints of live conferences. You want to hear two speakers, they're scheduled at the same time. Or the two workshops are at different ends of the stadium of booths and you miss it or you get distracted. So DMSC live stream is going to be just like a live conference experience. We'll have keynotes and panels and workshops. There is an exhibit hall, so you can go into the exhibit hall, visit the Experian booth for a live demo. You could request that local market report and talk about the different ways that Experian data can help your business. We're going to have live networking sessions. And then on Monday and Tuesday night, the great team at Experian are our sponsors for our virtual wine tasting. So Monday night, we have Jason Moore. He's the winemaker from Modus Operandi Wines in California. And Tuesday, we have Sarah and Luke Marquist, the owners and winemakers of Molly Duker Winery in Australia. So we have the best of the best in content. And then at the end of each day, an opportunity to relax, to unwind, and then to network with your peers. And we thank the team at Experian for making this educational event possible. If this is the first time you're listening to my podcast, you should know that every week I release a new podcast interviewing industry leaders, movers and shakers, and developments in the auto industry. This podcast is a special part of the Road to DMSC series. And I encourage you to listen to all those podcasts because many of those companies will be also speaking and presenting at DMSC this year. Don't forget to visit your common podcast feed. This podcast is called the Pash On Podcast. You can see it on the Apple Music Channel, Google Play, SoundCloud, Spotify, and of course on the native player Libsyn. So it's brianpash.libsyn.com. Amy, thank you so much for being on today's show. And I want to thank all the dealers and industry leaders who listen. We'll catch you next time on another podcast session.